All right. Welcome back to thecloudchurch.org. I'm Robert Breaker, missionary evangelist to the Spanish and English-speaking people. And we've been going verse by verse through the epistles of Paul. We are now in the book of Galatians. And last week we just started up on the book of Galatians, and we got all the way down to about verse 10. And I wanted to start again this week, but back up just a tad, because just as soon as I got off the phone last week, or excuse me, just as soon as we finished up last week, my phone rang, and it was a friend, a fellow friend that went to Bible school with me. He said, "What you doing?" I said, "Well, we're going verse by verse through the book of Galatians." He said, "Oh yeah, Galatians." He said, "Did you mention the Mormons?" And we had just talked about that. And he says, yeah, the Bible says, "Though we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel unto you than what you would preach, let him be accursed." He said, "Joseph Smith said an angel appeared from heaven and said unto him, 'Hey man, here's a new gospel for you.'" And he reminded me that it wasn't just one angel, according to the Mormons. It was two angels, one named Moroni and one named Nephi. And he said, that's why the King James Bible mentions this twice, because of the two angels that appeared unto Joseph Smith. So, sure enough, it does say twice, "Though we or any angel from heaven preach anything other than what we preach unto you, let him be accursed." Verse 8, and then verse 9, "And we said before, so say I now again, if any man preach any other gospel unto you than that which ye have received, let him be accursed." So it's fun talking to an old Bible school student, and I appreciate him calling and mentioning that. And sure enough, twice is it mentioned. That's how zealous that God is of his gospel. "That if any angel from heaven preaches another gospel than that which you've heard, let him be accursed." So, how interesting that the Bible mentions that twice. And yet, there's a gigantic denomination in the world today that says, "Oh, we started with another gospel that an angel gave to us." In complete contrary to what the Bible teaches. It's incredible. So now we're going to continue in our books of Galatians. And like I said before, we ended in verse 9. So we will begin in verse 10. And I appreciate you being here. I hope this has been a blessing to you. I really enjoy the book of Galatians. And I really think that this is a foundational book. We started with 1st and 2nd Thessalonians, and we looked at some of the things that Paul was talking about there, and you know, the rapture, the day of the Lord, the day of Christ, things that will happen in the future, how we as Christians should love one another. It's a good book for Christians to grow. But now the book of Galatians is an excellent book for, it's actually the heart of New Testament doctrine, because it shows us the difference of being saved by faith alone and being saved by keeping the law. So let me draw this out for you real quick as we go through here, because this is so important. So many denominations do not understand the Bible. Let's put Adam over here, the first man. So Adam was here at the beginning. Now later, up shows up Abraham in the Bible. I can redo that. And then shows up Moses. And we know that God chose Abraham, Isaac, Jacob. And Jacob's name was changed to Israel. Israel, of course, are the Jews, the people of God. So God chose for himself a people, the Jews. And with Moses, God chose the law. Well, this book, the book of Galatians, speaks about the law, but it also speaks about Jesus Christ. And we remember that the Bible says the law and the prophets were unto John. So John the Baptist showed up. And then the Bible says that he showed up for one purpose, according to John chapter 1 and verse 31. John showed up baptizing to manifest to Israel Jesus Christ, their Messiah. So Jesus shows up. Now after Jesus shows up, we have what's called the church age. And we are in the church age today. The church age starts with Jesus Christ. He starts the church. Then the apostles. But then God pulls out one man, Paul, and says, "Paul, you are the apostle to the Gentiles." Romans chapter 11 and verse 13. So all of the books of the Bible for us today in the church age, of all the books in the Bible, the books of the apostle Paul, all 14 books, some people say 13, I won't go into that right now. But the books of Paul are the books that are the heart of New Testament doctrine. And the books that are for us today. So, Paul is our apostle. So here is the church age. And in the church age, we're saved by grace through faith. Through faith. So grace through faith. Or we'll just say grace and faith. But under the law, how were you saved? Well, of course you had to have some faith in the Old Testament. The Bible says they should live by their own faith. But what was their faith in? It was in their own righteousness. You see, you had to do right according to the law. Let me put a righteousness. So, the law had a lot to do with works. Works were certainly necessary under the law. Now, what happens if under the law you broke the law? Well, thank God you could have a sacrifice. And a sacrifice was made on your behalf. Or you took a lamb or a turtle dove or a bullock or whatever you had that the Bible allowed you to sacrifice. And that blood that you sacrificed, that took care of that sin that you just committed. But the Bible says that sacrifice, when God forgave you, it gave you remission. Remission, that's an interesting word. Up shows Jesus Christ, the one the Bible calls the Lamb of God. So here in the Old Testament, it was a lamb. Well, I'll write it in red since I pulled out the red cap. But in the New Testament, we have the Lamb, Jesus Christ. And Jesus Christ shed his own blood on the cross of Calvary for our sins. He is the one sacrifice forever. And through Jesus Christ, we have redemption. Now, what is the difference between redemption and remission? Well, people that get cancer, if the cancer stops spreading, they say, oh, it's in remission. But guess what? It can come back. So it hasn't been cured. So in the Old Testament, redemption wasn't there. It was remission, which meant a man sinned in the Old Testament under the law, he offered sacrifice for that past sin that he did. But in the future, he could still sin, and if he did, he had to bring another sacrifice, and another sacrifice, and another sacrifice. But yet, in the New Testament, Jesus shows up. And in Romans chapter 10 and verse 4, we are told that Jesus Christ is the end of the law. Oops. He's the end of the law. That means we are no longer under the law, but under grace. And when we're saved by Jesus Christ through faith, faith in what? Faith in the blood, faith in the gospel. And we're going to look at the gospel a little bit today, as it's mentioned here. When we're saved, we have redemption. That means all of our sins, past, present, and future, have been paid for. Redemption means to buy back. It means to redeem something, to buy it back. So Jesus Christ bought us by his own blood. He bought the church. And our sins, because Jesus can't die again, our sins are forgiven eternally. We have eternal redemption, eternal salvation. So you see the difference between the Old Testament and the New Testament. In the Old Testament, their sins were just remitted. But they were only the sins that they did in the past. That means if a man lived right all his life and sinned one time, he had to do that one sacrifice. Well, he was saved then until he sinned again. Let's say he sinned again, but he never offered another sacrifice. Then he died and went to hell. Because he had his sins paid for that he did before, but every time he sinned, he had to have another sacrifice and another sacrifice and another sacrifice. But Jesus Christ, the Bible says, died once for all. One sacrifice forever. So one sacrifice forever, the Bible says, Jesus Christ died. So that means all of our sins, past, present, and future, even the sins we haven't even committed yet, have all been paid for right here by Jesus Christ. That's what's so great about grace and salvation. There's no more need for another sacrifice. The sacrifice, the one sacrifice for sin forever, has been made through Jesus Christ. So as we go through the book of Galatians, we're finding that this does not apply to us today. We don't need this for salvation. We need Jesus for salvation. That's why, for example, Galatians 2:16, knowing that a man is not justified by the works of the law, back here, but by the faith of Jesus Christ. Even we have believed in Jesus Christ, and we might not be justified, that we might be justified by the faith of Christ, not by the works of the law, for by the works of the law shall no flesh be justified. So we are not living in this time period where we are saved by the works of the law. We are saved or justified or redeemed by the faith of Jesus Christ, by trusting in Jesus Christ, by our faith in him. That's what's so important, because you have many denominations in the world today that don't know this. You've got your Seventh-day Adventists. What they try to do is they try to say, oh, this is all great and everything over here, what Jesus did, but you've got to keep the law or else you'll go to hell. So basically, they're denying this for salvation, and they're saying, no, you still got to do this. You've got the Mormons, and the Mormons said, this is fine, but that's not important. Here's a new gospel out here that you have to start with. And so the Mormons show up and say, hey, this angel showed up and gave us a new gospel. Well, wait a minute. I just read a verse by Paul that said if some angel shows up and gives you a new gospel, he's accursed. So see how different denominations all try to get away from what the Bible teaches and divert you somewhere other than Jesus Christ. And you've got your Jehovah's Witnesses. They believe you're saved by works. You've got all these different denominations. You've got to follow the scriptures and not men. So what we're going to find out in this book as we're reading the book of Galatians is that the people that got saved out of this got saved and realized you're not saved by the law. But then in come people here and say, no. Even though you're saved by this, you've got to keep the law. And this book of Galatians will show us dogmatically it's not keeping the law that saves us. We're not saved by grace through faith plus works. We're not saved by works alone. We're saved by grace through faith plus nothing minus nothing. It's not of works, lest any man should boast. So with that stated, we'll go ahead and get started here. And in verse 10, Galatians chapter 1 and verse 10, the Apostle Paul says, "For do I now persuade men or God? Or do I seek to please men? For if I yet pleased men, I should not be the servant of Christ." So what is he saying? He's saying, as a minister of the gospel, I'm not trying to please people. I'm trying to please God. And what does it mean to please God? Please man. What is the definition of being a man pleaser? Go to Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 6. Ephesians 6:6 shows us what a man pleaser is. What is a man pleaser? What is a person that tries to please men? What do they do? Ephesians 6:6 says, "Not with eye service as men pleasers, but as the servants of Christ doing the will of God from the heart." So Ephesians 6:6 tells us what a man pleaser is. It's someone who with eye service tries to do things so that others can see them doing it and say, "Oh, look at me." So it's pretty much like the Pharisees. Jesus talks about the Pharisees, and they walk around, they say, "Oh, look at me, I'm so righteous and I'm so wonderful." Even Jesus rebuked the Pharisees because he said they fasted and then they painted white their face. So it made it look like they were fasting so much that they got sick. And paisley. And they're walking around all self-righteous. What are they? They're man-pleasers. They're trying to show outwardly, "Look how great I am," when inwardly, Jesus said of them, they're ravaging wolves. So what is Christianity? It's not about looking great on the outside and bragging on yourself and saying, "Look how wonderful I am." It's about looking at Jesus Christ and saying, "Look at how great he is and what he's done for us, because he's saving us by grace through faith. We're not saved by the law. We're saved by him who did it all for us." So that's what it is. He says we're not men pleasers. We're not seeking to persuade men. All we're doing is trying to please God by preaching the gospel. So back to Galatians chapter 1, verse 10. "For do I now persuade men or God? Or do I seek to please men? For if I yet pleased men, I should not be the servant of God." There are a lot of people out there that claim to be ministers nowadays, and all they're trying to do is please men. And guess what? They're not servants of Christ by doing that. They're serving their own bellies, as it says in another passage. So verse 11 is something very revealing, something very interesting that Paul reveals unto us. He says, "But I certify you, brethren, that the gospel which was preached of me is not after man." So Paul says, "I am not preaching another gospel, one that man made up." Well, in verse 7, 8, and 9, we read of the other gospel. Well, we'll go back to verse 7, "which is not another, but there be some that trouble you." Okay, so let's go back to verse 6 now. "I marvel that you are so soon removed from him that called you into the grace of Christ unto another gospel." So we're saved by grace, and yet someone came along and tried to move them to another gospel. Hey, I remember the Mormons are the ones that came along with another gospel. What were they trying to do? Remove you or change you from Christ into something else. That's what other gospels do. They go away from Jesus Christ and his blood atonement and try to teach that you can do something to be saved. So he says, "which is not another, but there be some that trouble you that would pervert the gospel of Christ." They want to change the gospel. But though we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel than that which ye have preached unto you, I let him be accursed. As we said before, so say I now again, if any man preach any other gospel unto you than that which ye have received, let him be accursed. So then Paul says in verse 11, but I certify you, brethren, that the gospel which was preached of me is not after men. And then he says, for I received it, neither received it of man, neither was I taught it, but by the revelation of Jesus Christ. So what is this gospel which he's speaking about? Well, just about every week I try to give you the gospel. I just believe it's so important because so few people preach this gospel nowadays. Many churches are preaching a different gospel. Some are over here trying to get you under work. Some are out here saying, hey, follow us in this new angel and this new gospel. Some are trying to get you to do, oh, you can get saved like this, but then you got to do this. They're just changing the gospel, and it's all to divert you from trusting solely in Jesus Christ. So what is the true gospel? It's 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through 4, and it has 5 points. The first one is that Christ died. You say, well, lots of people preach that, and that's all they preach. For our sins. Oh, I've heard people preach that. Well, most people that claim to preach the gospel, that's as far as they go. They don't preach anything else. Christ died for our sins. But the Bible says he was buried, and he rose again. And then it says, according to the scriptures. And so important is this, that it's mentioned twice. So let's look at 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through 4. I hope you know what the gospel is. If you don't, now's a good time to learn. And this is what we're supposed to preach to lost people. This is what it's all about, the gospel. What is the gospel? 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through 4 says, moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel. So Paul says, I'm declaring unto you the gospel, which I preached unto you. Well, Paul just said in verse 11 of Galatians, I certify you, brethren, that the gospel which was preached of me is not after man. So this is the gospel that he's preaching because he says he's preached this unto them. It says, which I preached unto you, which also you have received, and wherein you stand. We must stand in the gospel. It's only through this that we can be saved, not the law. Not some angel coming and perverting and giving us a different gospel. It's only through this that we can be saved by faith. By which also ye are saved. So we're saved by the gospel. If you keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless ye have believed in vain. For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he was rose again the third day according to the scriptures. So the gospel for salvation for us today, Paul says that he was the one that started preaching it, was revealed to him, and he preached the gospel. He preached the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ according to the scriptures. And he said, this alone is salvation. So it's all right there. I certify to you, go back to Galatians chapter 1, verse 11, but I certify you, brethren, that the gospel which was preached of me is not after men. For neither I received it of man, neither was I taught it but by the revelation of Jesus Christ. So God revealed unto him what the gospel was. And God said, Paul, this is what I want you to preach and teach to everyone. Now a lot of people say, well, didn't the early apostles preach that? Well, this is a subject of much debate, and it's worth looking at. So let's go back to the book of Acts, because most people don't understand that the book of Acts is a transitional book. And it's a transitional book from the Jews to the Gentiles. So yes, the early apostles preached the death, burial, and resurrection. They preached Christ died, he was buried, and rose again. But very few times did they preach for your sins. And a lot of times, these early apostles, when they were preaching this, they were preaching who Jesus was, because they were preaching to Jews. So all the emphasis wasn't on what Jesus did, it was on who Jesus was. Then Paul comes along and God says, Paul, look, this is what I did and this is why I did it. And the emphasis became in what the gospel was. It wasn't just who Jesus was, it's what he did was to save us and justify us before God. So let's look at that briefly. Go to the book of Acts and go to Acts chapter 2. And verse 1 says, when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all in one accord. Suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a mighty rushing wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting, and appeared unto them cloven tongues like as of fire, and it set upon each one of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and began to speak with other tongues. And why is that? Verse 5, and there were dwelling at Jerusalem Jews, devout men out of every nation. So they were filled with the Holy Spirit while they were sitting in a room. How do we get the Holy Spirit today? Well, we've looked at it before, Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 13. After you hear the gospel, let's go ahead and look at it and believe it. That's how you get the Holy Spirit. So what's Ephesians? Galatians, Ephesians 1, 13. In whom ye also trusted after that ye heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation. In whom after that ye believed, you were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. So today, through the preaching of Paul, receiving the Holy Spirit is conditioned upon first hearing the gospel and then believing. And once you hear and believe, then you are sealed with the Holy Spirit of God. Now, what did I say earlier? I said that the book of Acts is a transitional book. So here we have the book of Acts right here. Acts is a transitional book. And in the book of Acts, there are people getting saved and getting the Holy Spirit in all different ways. Matter of fact, there's five different ways that a person gets the Holy Spirit in the book of Acts. So you can't base anything on the first couple chapters of Acts. You have to realize, as the book goes along, there is a transition from the Jew to the Gentile. And this is where most people hang their neck. There's a lot of Pentecostals that don't read the book of Acts. They just stop in Acts 2:38, and that's all they know. And they say, be baptized in water, and that's how you get the Holy Spirit. Well, that's how the Jews got it then. But how do we later, through Paul, get it? It's not through water baptism. It's by faith in the gospel. So there has been a change. There has been a transition that took place. Why is this? Well, look at Acts chapter 2, and let's go and look at verse 230. Well, let's go ahead and look at verse 37. Start in verse 36. So Peter stands up, and he's in Israel before all these Jews. And he tells them, hey, you guys have killed Jesus Christ. Look at verse 31. He says, he seeing this before spake of the resurrection of Christ, that his soul was not left in hell, neither did his flesh see corruption. So there's the resurrection. So he's talking about Jesus Christ. He said that he was slain, he was killed. So he is preaching this Christ that died and was buried and rose again. But then look at verse 36. Therefore let all the house of Israel, he's talking to Israel, know assuredly that God hath made this same Jesus whom ye both crucified, whom ye have crucified, both Lord and Christ. Now when they heard this, they were pricked in their heart and said unto Peter and to the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? They do not say, what shall we do to be saved? We see in Acts chapter 16 a different question. In Acts chapter 16 and verse 30, look at this question. And brought them out and says, sirs, what must I do to be saved? And they said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved in thy house. So in one passage, you have Israel, the Jewish leaders of Israel, saying, what do we do, seeing that we crucified our Messiah? And they're told to be baptized in water. Later, in Acts 16, when Paul is preaching, these Gentiles say, what should we do to be saved? And Paul says, believe. So there is a difference. There is a transition from the Jews to the Gentiles. And the early Jews in the early part of the church, they had to be baptized in water to receive the Holy Spirit. But as time went on, there was a transition period and a changing because the Jews rejected, the Jews as a whole, the Jews as a nation, rejected Jesus as their Messiah. So God slowly took the gospel to the Gentiles, and God chose Paul, and he told Paul, this is what you preach. All right, now, this is what a lot of people don't get, and this is so interesting. Jesus died here. He was in the earth 3 days and three nights and rose again. He could have come back right there and set up the millennial kingdom if the Jewish nation had received him. All that would have had to taken place was there had to have been the tribulation here. And I guess Judas would have been the Antichrist. It's possible. But because the Jews rejected Jesus, God said, okay, I'm going to make the church age 2,000 years. I'm going to go away from Israel, and I'm going to save the Gentiles. At the end of this is the rapture. And that's when God comes back to the Jews, is in the tribulation. We find that talked about in Romans 11, how they were cut off and the Gentiles were grafted in. But God's not done with the Jews and he'll come back to them. So a lot of people don't rightly divide the word of truth. They don't understand that the book of Acts is a transitional book that starts with Jews and goes to Gentiles. It starts with a gospel of water baptism, remission of sins, and then ends up as, okay, to the Gentiles by grace through faith, trusting in the finished work of Jesus Christ. Well, in other words, I like to say it like this. When they were preached unto the Jews, they were preached, believe on the name, believe on who Jesus is, in whom there's no other name under heaven. What was the name of Jesus? His name is Jesus. That's two different words. That means Jehovah saves. Jesus, the word Jesus, means Jehovah saves. And when they were being preached to in the early part of the church, the emphasis is on who Jesus is. He was the Messiah. And they had killed their Messiah. And because they killed their Messiah, they needed to be baptized and repent of that sin of murdering their Messiah. But as it went along and it transitioned from Jew to Gentile, then the emphasis became, what did that man do for us? What did God, Jesus Christ, do for us? And how are we saved? By trusting in what he did. It's not just trusting in his name and who he is. It has to be, oh, we rely upon that sacrifice. We trust what he's done on the cross. We trust the blood for salvation. Now, if you can't get that, you can't get that. But that's sound Bible doctrine. And if you don't get that, you're going to err so far into one side or the other that you're going to either end up a Mormon or a charismatic who doesn't read any further than Acts chapter 2 or one of these Seventh-day Adventists who think you have to keep the law. But if you read the Bible and understand and rightly divide, we are here in the church age. And we are not saved the way these people were. We are saved by this gospel that Paul just told us in Galatians chapter 1 was revealed unto him. He is our apostle. We have to come to God through the apostle Paul. But let's look at a couple places in the book of Acts in which the early apostles did preach that it's the Jesus that died and was risen again. And I didn't even read verse 38. So let me read verse 38. I diverted away from that. Starting in verse 37. Now when they, that's the Jews, heard this, they were pricked in their heart and said unto Peter and the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? Israelis saying to other Jews, what shall we do since we killed our Messiah? Verse 38 says, then Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ. The emphasis was always on the name in the early church, on who Jesus was. But as it progressed in the transitional book, through Paul, the emphasis was on what Jesus did. And he did that to save us, for our sins. So, continuing in verse 38, and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. For the promise is unto you, and to your children, and to all that are far off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call. So this was for the Jews, and they would get the remission of sins through the baptism in water. They would receive the Holy Spirit. Because that was a transition period where they were still Jews, and it was still going to the Jews. Now there is a denomination today called the Church of Christ. And the Church of Christ, that's all they know, is what I just read to you. And they believe that water baptism saves. Well, if that's true, why did the Apostle Paul say this? Let's go to 1 Corinthians chapter 1. You see, water baptism doesn't save us today. So there must have been a transition period, like I told you, from Jews to Gentiles. From the preaching of who Jesus is, to trusting in what Jesus did for us, the gospel. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, look at verse 14. The Apostle Paul, our apostle, who said that God gave and revealed unto him the gospel to preach to the world, says, I thank God I baptized none of you. Now, if we're saved today by water baptism, as the Church of Christ teaches, then why would Paul say, thank God I didn't baptize any of you? Well, that would be him saying, thank God you didn't get saved. But look what he says. I thank God I baptized none of you but Crispus and Gaius, but just these two guys, these two people. He said, lest any should say that I have baptized in my own name. And I baptized also the household of Stephanus, besides I know not whether I baptized any other. And Paul, but if salvation was by baptism, why would he say that? Why would he make light of it if that was the way to be saved? But look at verse 17. For Christ sent me not to baptize, but to preach the gospel, not with the wisdom of words, lest the cross of Christ should be made of none effect. So he says, Christ sent me not to baptize, but to preach the gospel. So back here, with Peter and the apostles, the emphasis was who Jesus was and be baptized in water to get the Holy Spirit. But as the book of Acts, a transitional book, continued, salvation became, no, it's trust the gospel to be saved. The baptism doesn't save you. Matter of fact, in Acts 16, verse 30, what must I do to be saved? Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. It says afterwards they baptized them. So salvation came by faith. And water baptism was something they did later. And it wasn't for salvation. The water wasn't what saved them. It's the belief. Hearing the gospel and believing. So why would Paul say, Christ sent me not to baptize, but to preach the gospel? Because Paul was going to the Gentiles, and he was preaching the gospel of salvation. And we are not saved by water baptism today. In verse 18, for the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but unto us which are saved it is the power of God. So salvation is by faith. It's the power of God, the gospel. Now that's not to say that the early apostles didn't mention this. They did. And we can't go through the book of Acts without seeing it. Let's look at some examples in Acts. Go to Acts chapter 3 and verse 13. The God of Abraham and of Isaac and of Jacob, the God of our fathers, hath glorified his son Jesus, whom ye delivered up and denied him in the presence of Pilate, who they delivered him up to be killed. In verse 14, but ye denied the Holy One and the just and desired a murderer to be granted unto you and killed the Prince of Life. There's the death. Whom God hath raised from the dead. There's the resurrection. Whereof we are witnesses, and his name through faith in his name hath made this man strong. So see how the emphasis is faith in the name, faith in who Jesus is. They mention the death and burial and resurrection, but they're not saying this is how you get saved. Trust it. They're saying, trust him, who he is. So, we go through and we find, look at 4:10 in the book of Acts. Be it known unto you all, and to all the people of Israel, that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead, even by him doth this man stand here before you whole. Verse 11, neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. The emphasis to the Jews was the name of Jesus, because the name of Jesus shows who Jesus is. He is the Messiah. So to the Jews, the preaching is who Jesus is, so that they'll trust, hey, this was our Messiah, and believe in their Messiah. But as the book of Acts goes on, and it goes to Paul, the emphasis is the gospel, what Jesus did for us. We're not only supposed to believe who Jesus is, we're to trust what he did is sufficient to save us. And the only way to be saved is to trust the finished work of Jesus Christ. Now, I could go on, but I'll stop there. It's a lot of fun to read through the book of Acts. Because in Acts chapter 7, they stoned Stephen. That's the religious leaders of Israel killing Stephen, who preached salvation was in Jesus Christ, in the name of him. That's when the last nail in the coffin for the Jews of Israel, the nation rejected their Messiah. And then in chapter 8, the first thing we see, and Saul. So when those Jews rejected Jesus Christ, the nation of Israel, not all of them, some Jews were saved. The apostles won a lot of Jews to the Lord, but they were immediately kicked out of the synagogues. And the nation of Israel as a whole said, that's it, we don't want Jesus. And they began to persecute the early Christians. And so when the nation of Israel in chapter 7 of Acts rejected Jesus, then up shows Paul. The Bible says, okay, let me tell you about this guy named Paul. Well, Paul went around persecuting those early Christians, but God saved him in chapter 9 of Acts. Then in chapter 10, in chapter 10, Peter sees some Gentiles saved. Where's the word Gentiles? Right up here. So Peter got some Gentiles, and he couldn't believe it. Why would God save Gentiles? Well, because all of God's plan was to have a church made up of Jew and Gentile. So we see Gentiles saved. And as we go through the book of Acts, we see the ministry from Peter changing more to Paul. And Paul becoming the apostle to the Gentiles. So for us today, we have to follow Paul. Go to thecloudchurch.org and look at the video there on the front page about rightly dividing the word of truth and following Paul. Paul is our apostle. That's why we're going verse by verse through the epistles of Paul in order when they were written, because Paul is the apostle, and Paul's doctrine is the heart of the doctrine of the New Testament of the church. It's our doctrine for us today. We are not saved back here like the Jews were through water baptism and through believing in the name of Jesus. We are saved today by hearing the gospel, believing it, and trusting in what Jesus did. We know who Jesus is. But we're not saved just because we know who he is. Even the devils know who Jesus is, and they tremble. We trust what he's done. We rest in the gospel. We trust and rest. As we looked at one time on thecloudchurch.org, go to past sermons and look about the bloodstained gospel. I believe it was last week, or maybe it's this week. The bloodstained gospel versus the bloodless gospel. This gospel of salvation, you can't look at this without seeing the blood of Jesus Christ all throughout this gospel. It's all about the blood. It's all about trusting in the blood of Jesus Christ. Yet to these Jews, when the church started, it was all about water. And it wasn't about trusting in the blood. So there was a transformation, a transition through the book of Acts. And you've got to understand that in order to understand the Bible. That's the only way to be saved, is through Paul and through this gospel. So we'll stop there when it comes to looking at the book of Acts. Maybe one day we'll get to go verse by verse through the book of Acts. I'll show you the five different times somebody gets saved in a different way in the book of Acts, and they get the Holy Spirit. It's a transition period. There's a lot of differences between Jews and Gentiles. But that's that's another study. So, excuse me, back to Galatians chapter 1. Galatians chapter 1. And it says in verse 11, "But I certify you, brethren, that the gospel which was preached of me is not after man." So Paul didn't take his gospel and just make it up. Nor was it something man taught. He says, "For I neither received of man, nor was I taught it, but by the revelation of Jesus Christ." So God revealed something into Paul. And God separated, we're about to see, separated Paul to have him for a specific time and a specific purpose in the church age to take the gospel to the Gentiles. Now, I've stated it before, Paul did not only preach to Gentiles, he also preached to Jews. Same with Peter. Peter never just preached to Jews, he also preached to some Gentiles. But the Jews were the early church, and Peter's, we'll see it later, the gospel of circumcision, the gospel of the uncircumcision, Peter was more to Jews, and Paul was more to Gentiles. That's the way God set it up. And I believe that probably has to do with those two keys that Jesus Christ was talking about. And I'm talking about how Peter, you received these two keys. Well, one's a key to the Jews, one's a key to the Gentiles. But that's a completely different teaching. We can't get into that now. So back to verse 12. "For I neither received of man, neither was I taught it, but by the revelation of Jesus Christ." Verse 13. "For you have heard of my conversation in time past in the Jews' religion, how that beyond measure I persecuted the church of God." Now that shows us that the church existed from Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ started the church. There are many, many verses to prove that. And he persecuted the church, so the church must have existed before Paul. There are some people that preach the church started with Paul. Now there are so many verses that prove otherwise. Colossians 1:18 says, let's look at that. Colossians 1:18. It says, "And he is the body..." Excuse me, it's talking about Jesus Christ. It says, "He is the head of the body, the church." He is Jesus Christ. That's what it's talking about. It says, "He is the head of the body, comma, the church. Who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things he might have the preeminence." So the church starts with who? The head. Jesus Christ is the head of the church. So even though these early Jews weren't saved the same way that we are today, they were put into the church. They started the church. So they're part of the church. Let's look at some more verses on that. Because there's some people that say, "Oh, that's too far-fetched. I can't believe that." And before we get there, let me say this. The body of Christ. Maybe you've heard that term, the body of Christ. Well, Colossians 1:18 says, "The body, comma, the church." So the body of Christ is the church. So the church is the body, and the body is the church. So what is the body of Christ? Well, that's all people that are saved during the church, whether they're Jew or Gentile. We'll just look at a couple of verses on that. Let's go to 1 Corinthians chapter 12. There's so many verses. I've actually just finished a teaching on this. When did a church start? and we go verse by verse, and we look at many of these verses that we're looking at now to see exactly when the church started, and it started with Jesus. And the church is the body of Christ. And even though these Jews received the Holy Spirit in a different way than we did today, according to the Bible, they are part of the church. And the church is the body. Look at this. 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and verse 27. 1 Corinthians 12, 27 says, "Now ye are the body of Christ and members in particular." So the body of Christ. What is the body of Christ? Oh, it's the church. So Paul is saying, you are the church. You are the body of Christ. Now look at verse 28. "And God hath set some in the church," which is the body, according to Colossians 1:18. "First apostles, secondarily prophets, thirdly teachers," after that. So where are the apostles? Well, obviously the apostles were these 12 Jews that started preaching only to the Jews and were preaching the water baptism. So they must have been in the church. They become part of the body of Christ. Now, Galatians chapter 1, Paul says, "God revealed unto me the gospel." There were a lot of things that God revealed unto Paul. And when he revealed unto him, Paul went back and told these early people, "Hey, God revealed something to me." One of the things God revealed was the body of Christ. Let me look at this verse. Let me show you what I'm talking about here. Okay, here it is. Let's go to Ephesians chapter 3. One of the things God revealed unto Paul was the body of Christ. And what is the body of Christ? Who is in the body of Christ? According to the Bible, we find out that it's Jews and Gentiles are in part of the body of Christ. Because the body of Christ is the church, and the church started with the apostles, started with Jesus Christ and the apostles. So in Ephesians chapter 3, look at this. We'll start reading in verse 1. "For this cause I, Paul, the prisoner of Jesus Christ, for you Gentiles, if you have heard of the dispensation of the grace of God which is given me to you ward, how that by revelation he made known unto me the mystery." So God revealed the mystery unto Paul. What is the mystery? "As I wrote afore in few words, whereby when you read you may understand my knowledge of the mystery of Christ, which in other ages was not made known unto the sons of men, as it is now revealed unto his holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit, that the Gentiles should be fellow heirs of the same body and partakers of his promise in Christ by the gospel." Doesn't get any plainer than that. By this gospel, by this preaching, the Gentiles become fellow heirs in the same body. So by Paul going to these Gentiles and preaching to them this, when they got saved into the same body that these Jews were saved into back here. So the body of Christ is made up of Jew and Gentile who have come and trusted in Jesus Christ and received the Holy Spirit. Now, granted, the Jews received it in a different way than the Gentiles did. The Gentiles by the gospel. And that verse makes it so clear that the Gentiles should be fellow heirs and of the same body and partakers of his promise in Christ by the gospel. The gospel made the Gentiles saved and also put them into the same body that was already started, which is the body of Christ, the church. But there's many, many more verses on that. If you want to see that, go to the preaching. I believe I'll put it up next week, or if not, the week after that, about when did the church start. And you can look it up under past sermons. We're going to go ahead and make it a sermon. I thought about putting it under Bible studies, and I might put it there as well. But when did the body of Christ start? What is the body of Christ? Clearly, the Bible teaches the body of Christ is the church. The body of Christ is also called the bride of Christ. And who is in the bride? Who is the church? The church starts with Jesus and starts with the apostles. The body does. We've saw that verse. And then the revelation to Paul is that through the gospel, Gentiles can be fellow heirs in the same body, can be saved into the body of Christ. But it's not the way the Jews were, by being baptized in water. It's by hearing the gospel and believing, then being sealed with the Holy Spirit of God. So thank God for Paul. Paul is used by God to give us Gentiles the way to be saved. Now let's go back to Galatians chapter 1. Galatians chapter 1. And it says, "For ye have heard," I'm in verse 13, "of my conversation in time past in the Jews' religion, how that beyond measure I persecuted the church of God and wasted it." Well, if Paul persecuted the church, then the church must have existed before Paul. There are many people out there that say, no, the body of Christ starts with Paul. Well, the church is the body of Christ, and the body of Christ is the church. We saw that verse that says, the body, comma, the church. So if the church existed before Paul, what does that mean? It means the body of Christ existed before Paul, so the body of Christ starts here. When does the body of Christ begin? I believe it begins at the cross. Let me see if I can find that. Yeah, Ephesians 2:16. It says in Ephesians 2:16, that he might reconcile both unto God in one body by the cross. And then verse 20, and are built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ being the chief cornerstone. The context of Ephesians chapter 2 is the body. And the body starts with Jesus Christ, the chief cornerstone, the head. The body starts, and it says that the reason the body was started was to reconcile both unto God. Both. Who's both? Jew and Gentile. Into one body. So that's what the Bible teaches about the body of Christ. But think about this for a minute. This persecution. Over here was Peter. And Peter always thought he was so great, and he was always standing up, and Peter always wanted to be looked at as, you know, the head of the church. He always thought of himself as, you know, the greatest of all the apostles. And he stood up and started preaching some things. And then along comes a guy named Saul and starts killing all of Peter's friends. I mean, Paul started just murdering and killing people in the church. I mean, complete just assassin. And he's going and getting letters from the chief priests and the Pharisees. Can I kill these heretics? And they're signing the letters. Yes, murder them. And Paul is killing people left and right. And then all of a sudden, Paul gets saved. His name was Saul at the time, and they changed it to Paul. And then Paul gets saved, and God starts revealing some things to Paul. Why didn't he reveal it to Peter? He was the one that started in the church. And then Paul comes along, and Paul comes over to Peter, as we'll see later in the book of Galatians, and it says that Paul rebuked Peter. Put yourself in the shoes of Peter there for a minute and think, hey, man, I'm like this with Jesus, man. I helped start his church, the body. I'm awesome. Look at me. Oh, no, this guy, Saul, he's persecuting me. And then later, this guy that persecuted you comes over and goes, hey, you're wrong. Let me tell you what's right. It would be very hard for a person to humble themselves and listen to something like that. But yet, that's what Peter did. As a matter of fact, in 2 Peter, let's go over there. I believe it's 2 Peter. Maybe it's 1 Peter. Let's look at what Peter says about Paul. It's probably 2 Peter. Yes, it's in 2 Peter. 2 Peter chapter 3. Look at what Peter says about Paul. If this doesn't show you that God chose Paul and that Paul is the one to follow, I don't know what else does. Because even Peter himself says, our beloved brother Paul. It shows that Peter accepted Paul. And if Peter accepted Paul, then he must have accepted Paul's gospel. It says here in 2 Peter chapter 3, starting in verse 15, an account that the long-suffering of our Lord is salvation, even as our beloved brother Paul, also according to the wisdom given unto him, hath written unto you, as also in all his epistles, speaking in them of these things, in which some things hard to be understood. Peter never really truly understood. Hey man, two in one body, okay. Peter didn't like Gentiles. He tried to separate himself from Gentiles. It says, some things which are hard to be understood, which they that are unlearned and unstable wrest, as they do also the other scriptures, unto their own destruction. So there are people, because they don't understand why we follow Paul, they wrest the scriptures unto their own destruction. Like the Seventh-day Adventists, they don't accept any of this, don't trust Christ, don't want him dying for their sins. They want to try to work their way to heaven by following the law. Like these Pentecostals who think, oh, we're saved. Or like these Church of Christ. Oh, yeah, man, we got to speak in tongues, Pentecostals. We got to get water baptized, Church of Christ. They don't understand, hey, this right here, that's over. Now the transition is to us Gentiles through the gospel. Or like these Mormons who showed up 100 years ago or so with another gospel and say, hey, we got a new gospel. Check it out. No, we don't need a new gospel. We are saved through Paul's gospel. Let them be accursed that try to make a new gospel. So, the only way to understand the scriptures is to read the book of Acts and understand, hey, this is a transition book. And it transitions from Jews to Gentiles. From trusting in who Jesus was to what he did, the gospel. And these people that are in the church age, starting when Jesus died, they become part of the body of Christ. And these Gentiles, thank God, become fellow heirs. Thank God we Gentiles can be saved. Because back here, we at Gentiles, we could not be saved. The only way before Jesus died that you could get salvation was to become a Jew. Become a Jewish convert. A Jewish proselyte, they call it. And you had to come through the law of Moses to God. So you would have to come, just like chapter 8 of Acts, we read about the Ethiopian eunuch. He was a Gentile, a black Gentile from Ethiopia. who came to Jerusalem. Why? Because he wanted to be a Jewish convert. So this is how it worked back then. We're not here anymore. We're not here anymore. We are here. And we are here through Paul. We can't go back and ask Peter, Peter, give me the gospel. Nowhere in the Bible does it say that God revealed unto Peter this. It says this was revealed to Paul, and the way to be saved is by hearing the gospel and believing, and that's how we receive the Holy Spirit of God. It's the only way you can read the Bible and understand it. It's the only way that the Bible teaches. So until you understand that, you cannot understand the Bible. You see how much time we have left. So we're at 50 minutes now. We might just stop here. I've got lots to say on this verse 13. So let's... I guess we'll stop there. I hate to stop. We've still got a few more minutes, but we've got so much more to say. So let's go ahead and stop there, and I'll read through what we read through again today, starting verse 10. For do I now persuade men or God, or do I seek to please men? For if I yet pleased men, I should not be the servant of Christ. We don't want to please men. A lot of times this teaching doesn't please men. Men want to be pleased and have their ears tickled by hearing some other gospel. Because this gospel they don't like, because it says you're saved by what Jesus did. And many men want to say, no, I've got to do something, because it makes them feel good to think they did something to get God's favor. But that's called grace. You don't do anything. He's already done it. You just come to Him and humble yourself and say, I'm no good. I accept what Jesus did. And it says, but I certify you, brethren, that the gospel which was preached of me is not after man. This came from God. This true gospel. For I neither received it of man, neither was I taught it, but by the revelation of Jesus Christ. If you want to come to Jesus Christ today, the only way is through the Apostle Paul. Because Paul said, Jesus Christ revealed this to me as the way of salvation. So come to Jesus through Paul. That's the way to be saved. For neither I received it of man, neither was I taught it, but by the revelation of Jesus Christ. Verse 13. For you have heard by my conversation in time past in the Jews' religion how that beyond measure I persecuted the church of God and wasted it. And we looked at what the church is. Now what is the church? It starts at Christ. And all the people that receive the Holy Spirit after Jesus Christ become part of the church. But we see it starts with Jews and it's different. And the transition takes place and it goes to Gentiles. And God calls Paul, and God gives him the gospel. And the way to be saved is hearing the gospel and believing the gospel today. But yet we as Gentiles can be fellow heirs with those Jews who got saved in the early part of the church. So we'll stop there. There's a lot to say about religion. He says the Jews' religion. So next time we'll talk about a little bit about what religion is. Because religion and salvation are not the same. We are not religious. If you are a Christian, you don't say, oh, I have such and such a religion. Because it was the religious crowd that killed Jesus Christ. Who killed Jesus? Those priests. And they were religious. And what government allowed it? Rome. So why would anyone want to belong to a Roman Catholic church that's full of priests when Rome and the Jewish priests killed Jesus Christ? I'll never understand that. And that church of Rome says, oh no, Peter is our apostle, and we start with Peter. But you're not Jewish. So see, there's all these false religions in the world today. The Jehovah Witnesses, the Seventh-day Adventists, the Church of Christ, these Mormons, the Catholics, the Charismatics. And what is it that they all have in common? They all reject Paul and this gospel. And they all try to come to Jesus Christ some other way. And this passage makes it so clear that Paul says, God revealed unto me this. And this is the way to be saved. And if you want to be saved today, it's only by hearing this gospel, believing it, that's how you receive the Holy Spirit. That's how you're sealed. And that's how you become part of the body of Christ. If you're lost today, I hope today is the day that you come to Jesus Christ. I hope you understand the gospel. When it says Christ died for our sins, that means He literally took all of your sins, every one, past, present, and future. And when He died on that cross, God put your sins on Him, and then God cast out His wrath on your sins. Your sins are paid for. But you don't receive that until you receive Him. It's all done. It's like you go and you get in debt up to your eyeballs by gambling, and you owe $40 million debt. I mean, an outrageous amount that no way in your life can you ever pay. And then up comes Jesus and he says, look what I've done for you. He writes a check and he writes it in red in his own blood. And it says your name and then it says $40 million. That gambling debt is paid for. And he holds the check out. All you have to do is to take that check and give it to the creditors. And you're debt free. But yet men try to say, no, I can work. I can work my own. I can pay this off. You'll never pay it off. Jesus has already paid it. He's done everything. All you have to do is receive it. Receive that payment. And if you receive it, then you're saved. That means you trust what he's done for you. And the fact that he was rose again proves that he was God. That means God. That shows who he is. He is God manifest in the flesh. And only God could rise again according to scriptures. So salvation is only through Jesus. If you're lost today, today is the way to be saved. And it's by faith. Simply go to God and just say, I give up trusting in anything and everything I've done, and I trust solely and completely upon what you've done for me. I trust the blood. Salvation's that simple. It's not saying it with your mouth. It's whether or not you believe it in your heart. Do you believe that that's all it takes to get to heaven, is trust what he's done? If you say yes, and you believe it from your heart, then you're saved. But if you say, no, I've still got to do something, then you're lost. And you're like one of these people that we're going to look at next week who creep into the church and try to say, no, it's not by grace through faith. You still got to do these works. You see, when you're saved, it's not of works. We do good works because we're saved, not to get saved. It's not works that save us. Jesus did all the work that's necessary. Now, after we're saved, we work for him because we're saved, not to be saved. It's so simple, and yet it's so hard for people to understand. So I hope this has been a blessing to you today. We will look at the next chapters here soon, and I look forward to seeing you next time. Thank you.